So, as you know, in this class, we're going to be focusing on evaluating arguments, judging whether they're good or bad, and critiquing them. For the most part, we'll be looking very closely at deductive arguments, representing them in formal notation, and then using formal tools to evaluate them. But this might seem a bit far removed from everyday life. So, in this week and the next, we're going to talk about bad kinds of reasoning, and we'll learn to identify these bad reasoning patterns, or fallacies, which are things that come up in everyday conversation as well. Unfortunately, people are constantly making logical fallacies in their conversations, and so it can be very useful, although sometimes a little annoying, to be able to spot them as they come up. So we'll be going through a number of these examples and explaining when they apply. The names of the fallacies do suggest what exactly is wrong with the arguments that they apply to, but you'll still have to do a fair amount of memorization to be able to identify which fallacies apply to which situations. Okay, so with that in mind, let's get started. First, let's look at an obvious example of a fallacy, just to get things going. Imagine a child is trying to prove to his friend that he is the smartest kid in the class. His argument is, I'm the smartest kid in the class. My dad says so. Now, is this a good argument? Well, unless his dad is Albert Einstein or something, it's probably not a good argument. Just because your dad says something doesn't necessarily make it true. So this is an example of poor reasoning. The premise doesn't really provide good support for the conclusion. Let's look at another example. Milk is bad for you. I heard someone say that on the internet. Again, this is not a very good argument. The person is appealing to some random person that they heard on the internet, and this doesn't provide very strong support for the conclusion. Notice, however, that there is something similar about both of these rather weak arguments. They both involve trying to appeal to some alleged authority as a way of justifying their claims. And in both cases, the resulting argument is rather weak. So we will call this an example of a fallacy, specifically the fallacy known as appeal to authority. Oftentimes, we will be able to identify these kinds of patterns of bad reasoning, reasoning that is repeatedly misapplied in a number of different circumstances. So as logicians, as critics of arguments, we want to be able to give names to these patterns of bad reasoning, and that's what we will be exploring in this section. So we've already seen our first example of a fallacy, the appeal to authority. Appeal to authority is an argument that says that the conclusion must be true because somebody else says that it's true. Milk is bad for you. I heard someone say that on the internet. This is a fallacy because the mere fact that someone says something on the internet obviously does not make it true. I guess that's a weird thing for someone to say who's delivering lectures over the internet, but never mind that. Now, occasionally, it can be a good thing to appeal to an authority. If the authority is an expert, like a medical doctor, then it might be sensible to listen to their opinion. But the supposed authority being appealed to is not really knowledgeable about the subject matter, then it becomes a fallacy, which we will call appeal to authority, or appeal to an ignorant authority. In the rest of this video, we'll consider more examples of fallacies, or bad patterns of reasoning. First, let's look at appeal to force. In appeal to force, the arguer attempts to win the argument by attacking or threatening their opponent. For example, I should be the leader of this group. If anyone disagrees with me, I'll break their legs. Now, although this might be a pretty good way to win an argument, it obviously is not a rational argument. There's no reasoning involved as to why the conclusion is true. There is just a threat about what will happen if the arguer doesn't get his way. So this is clearly bad reasoning from a logical point of view. Next, let's consider appeal to pity. An argument that appeals to pity attempts to convince their opponent by making them feel sympathy or pity for the arguer's position. So for instance, I should be the leader of this group. If I don't get to be the leader, I'll feel so sad and pathetic. Now the opponent might be persuaded to agree with the arguer out of sympathy, but again, that's not really a rational basis for the conclusion. Next, we have subjectivism. A subjectivist argument is basically one which says that the conclusion is true simply because I think it's true. It's totally subjective. Whatever I say must be the case. So, for example, I should be the leader of this group. I just know I should, and I'm always right about these feelings. This is clearly a fallacy because you can't know something like that to be true just because you feel that it's true. A good argument should provide objective, logical reasons. Okay, let's pause here for a moment and return with some more fallacies.